Christ. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Greetings to you all. What is Easter Sunday? What is Easter? I want to look at some facts today before we look at the scripture that was read a few minutes ago. Got some notes here. It says, what is Easter Sunday? There's a lot of confusion regarding what Easter Sunday is all about. For some, Easter Sunday is about Easter bunny, colorful decorated Easter eggs, and Easter egg hunts. Most people understand that Easter Sunday has something to do with Jesus, but are confused as to how the resurrection is related to Easter eggs and Easter bunny. Biblically speaking, there is absolutely no connection between the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the modern day traditions related to Easter Sunday. The Bible makes it clear that Jesus was resurrected on the first day of the week, Sunday. Jesus' resurrection is most worthy of being celebrated. While it is appropriate for Jesus' resurrection to be celebrated on a Sunday, the day on which Jesus' resurrection is celebrated should not be referred to as Easter. Easter has nothing to do with Jesus' resurrection on a Sunday. As a result, many Christians feel strongly that the day on which we celebrate Jesus' resurrection should not be referred to as Easter Sunday. Rather, it should be referred to as Resurrection Sunday. I just want to bring this to your attention, just for your consideration. We are used to doing certain things, because we grew up in a certain way. So it doesn't really say anywhere that it's actually Easter. So by all means, celebrate Christ's resurrection on Easter Sunday. Christ's resurrection is something that should be celebrated not just on an Easter Sunday, but every day of the year. So what exactly is Easter? Where does the word Easter came from? I did some research. The seductive symbols of ancient ungodly religions inspired by Satan have been incorporated into people's lives, even to this day, continuing to obscure the truth of God. One might wonder if there is a better way for Christians to celebrate Jesus Christ's resurrection, the most important of all the Christian holy days. In retrospect, it seems obvious that it would have been better to witness to the world if Christians had not attempted to Christianize a pagan celebration. It actually is a pagan celebration, Easter. So the word Easter or Ishtar is actually the name of a pagan god. Attention has been shifted away from the spiritual truth towards materialism, clothing, products, candies with the wrong symbolism, store merchandise, the name of Easter, not as Resurrection Sunday, and sell goods that have nothing to do with Christ's death or the resurrection. Christians naively use symbols and practice that unknowingly perpetuate anti-Christ traditions. Symbolic customs followed by the same religious cults that inspired the destruction of a great number of Christians and Jews. Is the devil laughing at us because we are saying some things which have no meaning? It is very difficult. I beg a pardon if I did offend somebody, but I always say Happy Easter to many people. But God spoke to me and said, what if you want to change that? Where in today's world, instead of saying Happy Thanksgiving, they say Turkey Day. And for Merry Christmas, they say Xmas. And the Ten Commandments are removed away from churches and schools. And so, we as Christians, children of God, can we change something? Can we do something which actually is in line with the Word of God? Maybe we are a few people here. Maybe we may not change the whole world. Or maybe not we change everybody's opinions, and I do not want to change your opinion either, but I want you to consider. I want you to think about that. And next time if somebody wants to say, we could say something like Happy Resurrection Day, and Christ is risen is indeed definitely the most appropriate manner of vision. And like I said, Easter really has no meaning, and it actually resembles a pagan god. So I just want to give this thought, leave this thought with you this morning, and so may you consider the next time. And I had a hard time. I said it at Easter to many people today, and it takes time to probably get used to saying not to say things that you are used to saying. And so I just wanted you to consider if you want to say something different from henceforth. We all carry various burdens and struggles that sometimes that prevent us from living the life that God has designed for us to live, a life of love and light. Christ's sacrifice, though, reminds us that He defeated everything, even the last enemy, which is death. Thus, He is giving us a charge and asking us and challenging us to live and lead a life that He designed for us, that He wanted us to live. I want you to listen to a beautiful song by Matt Maher. It's a wonderful song. I want to, before I begin my sermon, I want to really want you to focus on this song and listen to the lyrics. Christ is risen, come away. Christ is risen, come away. And we have seen the lyrics and why he had to die. It's not just our sins, but our transgressions. He was bruised for our transgressions. Our iniquity was laid upon him. My brothers and sisters, today, if we are still living the same life that we once lived, it is shame to Christ's resurrection. It is a shame to Christ and his resurrection, because Christ died and he rose. We need to live a life that is full of joy and full of life. We'll look at the scriptures that we read this morning. Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. Shall we bow our heads even as we open the word with prayer? Father in heaven, I give you thanks and I give you praise this morning time, this wonderful morning, the day of joy and jubilation that Christ is risen. And we are here today to celebrate the victory over death. And Lord, we thank you for sending your only Son, Jesus, to us, Father. This morning, Lord, we come into your presence, offering our lives. And even as we meditate these words, let these words become life. And let them become, Lord, life to us, even as we meditate on the scriptures. Speak to us, Spirit God. Manifest your presence here this morning. We give you glory. We give you thanks. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. On the first day of the week, way back in the creation, God commanded light to shine. The very first day, God commanded, the first thing he said, let there be light. And on this day, 2000 years ago, the light of the world shined from the darkness of the grave. Hallelujah. The light of the world shined from the darkness of the grave. The birth of Jesus brought peace on earth. Luke chapter 2 verse 14 says, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. The birth of Jesus brought peace on earth. The death of Jesus brought peace in heaven. Luke chapter 19 verse 38 says, blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. The resurrection of Jesus brought peace within. Brought peace within. Colossians chapter 3 verse 15 says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace, and be thankful. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Friends, you see that at every area, Jesus had something for us to give. He offered something to us. At his birth, at his death, and his resurrection. As we read the scripture this morning, we know the story. On the very first day of the week, which is the Sabbath day, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb, and there was a great earthquake. And the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came, rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was the lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guard shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. Hallelujah. I want to like really stop here and really spend some time on this verse. Verse 6, chapter 28, verse 6. He is not here. He is risen, for he is risen. The Bible says Jesus is not here. He is not here anymore. He is not here. When we are ready to make this world our home and say it is good to be here, then let us remember that our Lord Jesus is not here. Amen? Amen. Let us remember Lord Jesus is not here. because he is risen. Therefore, let our hearts raise and seek the things that are above, for he is risen as he said. Let us never think that let us never think that it is strange, for the words of Christ have told us to expect both the sufferings in the present age and also the glory that is to be revealed. God's word always fulfills. Every promise that was spoken had been fulfilled and is being fulfilled even in this generation. And you know, God said, you will have troubles in this world, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. And that was his word. He already told that it's going to happen. So we should not be even surprised that we have troubles. And he also said in his word that I will see you in glory. And he has revealed it to us. And that's what the Bible says. He is not here. He is risen. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? I mean, many times we look for the right things in the wrong places. We look for the right things in the wrong places. We do the right thing in the wrong way. We do the right thing in the wrong way. And there are numerous examples all through the scriptures. And I do not want to go there, but I want to emphasize the point today. You know, as we read this, we want to stay here in verse 6. He is not here. If Jesus is not here, where is he? Any answers? Any clues? Well, he is in heaven. Hallelujah. He is in heaven, seated at the right hand of God. Jesus is not here. He is in heaven, seated at the right hand of God. But the Bible says that heaven is in your heart. Amen? Heaven is in your heart. He is in heaven. But if the heaven is in your heart, Jesus is in your heart. Amen? Hallelujah. He is not here. He is in heaven. That is his place. But the heaven is in your heart. You can make heaven to be in your heart. You could desire, and God will bring heaven into your heart. The Bible says the kingdom of God is nigh. It's very close. It's at hand. The kingdom of God is at hand. It's very close. It's right here. The kingdom of God. Jesus is in heaven, but the heaven is in your heart. Heaven should be not only in your heart, but heaven should be on your mind as well. Colossians chapter 3 verse 2 says, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Set your mind on things above. Focus your attention on things above. This is really what I want to share this morning, my brothers and sisters. We probably know the truth about the death and resurrection. We heard over and over. But one thing we probably have been missing is, what is next step? What is next? I am saved. I'm enjoying the salvation experience. I'm seeing the blessings. But what is next? I have the fruits of the Spirit. But what is next? And because of our toil, because of our burdens on this earth, sometimes we lose focus of what is ahead of us. What is our next step? What is our next step? There are two points, just very simple two points I want to bring to you this morning. The first one is, number one, the resurrection of Jesus is our consolation. The resurrection of Jesus is our consolation. The resurrection of Jesus brings comfort in our sorrows. It's joy unspeakable. The resurrection of Jesus is joy unspeakable. It is the peace that passeth understanding. The glory that protects us and the grace that provides us. The resurrected Lord will calm our fears, and the resurrected Lord will wipe your tears. Amen.
Amen.
He will calm all our fears and he will wipe your tears because he is resurrected. Because he has power and authority, and he has given the same power and authority to us. But how often do we really live a life of victory? We almost succumb to situations and circumstances in our life. We think that we are defeated, but it is not we who are defeated, it is the enemy that is defeated, the last enemy, that is the death. Think about this, my friends, this morning. What is the worst thing that could happen to you? You may be in debts, you may have diseases, you may have issues in your life, you may not have a job, but really, what is really that you have to worry about or you have to fear? It is really the death. But even the death, Jesus has overcome, and he has assured that those who believe in me, they will never die. And he gave us a proof. He showed us, and he walked out of the tomb. He walked out of the tomb. That should encourage us. That fact should reverberate in our hearts, in our minds, and it should encourage us and excite us every day of our life to look forward to that day when Jesus comes again. Or, if God forbid, if we have to be in the heaven today. Do not be afraid, for Christ rose from the dead to silence the people's fears, and there is enough to silence them. The disciples had just become shamefully deserted him in his sufferings, but to show that he could forgive them, Christ came and said, my brethren, do not be afraid. Do not fear. That is the first thing Jesus said when he came. Peace be with you. Do not fear. Even when, you know, times when we disown Jesus, when we disown our God, when we live like we do not know him at all, and God, Jesus, is still ready to forgive us. He's still saying, my brethren. The great argument to prove Christ to be the Son of Man is his death. The great argument to prove that truly Christ is the Son of Man is his death. And the great argument to prove that Christ is the Son of God is the resurrection. Hallelujah. It's the resurrection. It is because of the Father's enablement that Jesus could rise back. And as he said in his word, he came walking from the tomb. No one else did. An empty, a virgin womb and an empty tomb are the signs of a victorious Christian. If anybody asks, what is your faith? You can say boldly, a virgin womb and an empty tomb. Hallelujah. A virgin womb. How can a virgin have a womb? And how can a tomb be empty? It is impossible, but Christ made it possible. Christ made it possible. Jesus, the proof of the Father is in the Son. And the proof of love is the cross. And the proof of life is resurrection. Really, if somebody asks, you know, what's the proof? What on what basis do you believe? Why you believe what you believe? Why you believe what you believe? The proof of the Son. If there is a Son, that means there is a Father, right? If there is a cross, there is love. That's the proof. The proof of love is the cross. And the proof of eternal life is resurrection. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Jesus promised eternal life to all who believe in him. And where does this eternal life begin? I want to tell you this morning, brothers, the good news is the eternal life begins right here and right now. Amen? The eternal life begins right here, right now. You cannot go to heaven without the assurance of eternal life here on earth. You cannot go to heaven if you do not have the assurance right now, right here. You know, we need to have that assurance. Heaven on earth is Jesus in you. Hallelujah. Heaven on earth is Jesus in you. The power of resurrection, the resurrected Christ living in us, is the proof that heaven is there. Death is not a full stop. Death is only a comma. Death is just a pause, and then we move on, and we move on. Last weekend I was at a funeral to drive to Maryland, and one of our family members, we had attended a funeral, and I saw the body right here before the pulpit in the church, Western United Methodist Church in Maryland. The body lay there, and people giving their eulogy and saying nice things about this man. And when I looked at the body, there is nothing that body can do. And when the prayer was over, they closed the coffin, the prayer. And how deadly is that situation? Imagine your body right here, and you do not know. If you do not have the assurance here on earth that you will be in heaven, you have no hope. We have no hope. But, my brothers and sisters, Jesus is not here. The Bible says, chapter 28, verse 6, he is not here, for he is risen. There is a reason, because he's risen. Jesus said to the woman at this well, I am the resurrection and the life. John chapter 11 verse 25, the one who believes in me will live even though they die. This man was dead, but we believe he is alive. He is dead. The world will say he's dead, but we believe he's alive. We believe he's alive. That is our hope. That is what makes us distinct from the rest of the people or the rest of the faiths. My brothers and sisters, if all we have is this life to live, then we have to be pitied upon more than anybody. But we believe that we live forever. We live for eternity because of what Jesus did. He died and he rose again. I want to give you just a quick example of how we lose focus and how important for us to have heaven in our minds, heaven in our hearts.
Take this table for example. See how long this is. You don't even see the end of this. And this is how big is eternity. And look at this socket here. This is how small our life on earth is. This is how small our life on earth is compared to this table, which you don't even know where the end is. And that is eternity. And that is eternity. And this small life over here, 30, 40, 50, maybe 80. And you know, how we live this life. How we live life, this life is so important because it matters for the rest of eternity. And you see how big this is, you can't even measure. You don't even know the end. That's how big eternity is. And Jesus promised eternal life. And we need to guard our life so much so that we just don't live for this little bit here. This is so small, you can't even measure. You can't even compare how small this is when compared to eternity. This is our life on earth. This is our life on earth.
Our focus should be on heaven. We should be thinking about heaven. We should be singing songs with heavenly lyrics. We should always have a glimpse of heaven in our hearts, in our minds. Heaven should be in your hearts and your minds. And that is why Jesus is in heaven. He wants you to think of him in heaven, in glory, not as a Lamb of God, as but as a Lion of Judah. He's going to come back in power, and he has given us power to live a life that is acceptable, that is pleasing to him. We should not lose focus, my brothers and sisters. Heaven should be on your mind. You know, many people ask me, why after we are born again, and why do we have to go through these troubles through this life? Why do we have to, you know, wait this long? Jesus could probably just rapture all the believers and take to be with him. But there are lessons to learn. And for a lot of us, going to heaven will be a shock because we don't know how heaven will be. And in the Bible, Jesus spoke about heaven. And he said, this is how you live. Streets of golden, gates of pearls, you know, and it's such a rich life. But he wants you to get a taste of this here on earth. He wants you to be prepared. He says, I go to a place. There are rooms in my father's house. There are rooms. So it makes me wonder, it's one big house with so many rooms, like dormitory, right? Each one gets their own room. Room number 22, 32, 42. So it's one big house with many rooms. One big house with many rooms. And he says, I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And it made me wonder, what is Jesus preparing us? In fact, Jesus is preparing us for what he has already prepared for us. Hallelujah. He's preparing us today, in this generation, in this time, today, to what he has in store for us. He has great stores. There are gifts that have to be unwrapped. There are so many gifts he has for us. There are rewards awaiting for us. But brothers and sisters, we should not lose the focus. We should not live like this is all it is for life. Absolutely not. Like you said, I've seen the illustration. This is small. This small. Our life is here on earth, compared to our life on heaven in eternity. God said, "I'm preparing for you great things," and we need to have an idea about what we are going to do in heaven. And I read this book, Purpose to